Hey there once again, YouTube. My name is Ben Ferraiuolo. Now, this is just going to be a quick video that adds some additional information to my most previous video, which half of it was about Newberry Volcano and the recent low-frequency earthquakes that have occurred. Now, we learned some information about the magma chamber in that previous video, so if you wish to see it now, simply go to my channel, click videos, and watch my most recent video prior to this one. Also, don't forget to navigate the video via the parts section in the description box, since the video is kind of long. Newberry is one of my favorite volcanoes in the entire world, partly because it is so dynamic. It can range from large caldera-forming eruptions, regular explosive eruptions, and even lava flows. The area around Newberry is also very volcanic as well. Now, in the previous video, we were on this website here from the University of Oregon. We were on the Newberry Volcano, and again, we saw the magma chamber and talked about that as well. But there was another page right here. After the video was finished, I noticed that I did miss some amazing information, and I just had to make another video about it. Just as a reminder, Newberry still has a lot of magma down there. Not too much, but I believe there is much more magma than they claim. Possibly. The magma chamber lies between around 3 to 6 kilometers in depth, right under Newberry Caldera, which resides just south of Bend, Oregon. Newberry is a shield volcano in central Oregon that is still very active. It also has many hot springs throughout the area, and temperatures are much higher, or at least slightly higher than they should be, giving the impression that it is possible Newberry could be the next Cascade volcano to erupt. You know, I don't know that for sure, don't take my word for it 100%, and I could be completely wrong. However, Newberry is close to number one on my list of the next volcanoes to erupt in the Cascade Range. Now let's look at some additional information which I missed in my last video. Apparently, they even uploaded a short movie to YouTube visualizing the magma chamber. The text to the video is on this page. However, it seems the video right here is no longer available for some weird reason. All of this information is provided by the University of Oregon, and I will leave a link to this in the description box below. Let's read about this just real quick. Okay. This story is about scientists looking for a magma chamber beneath Newberry Volcano only 20 miles to the southeast of Bend, Oregon. People go fishing, kayaking, or skiing around Paulina Lake, which is one of the two lakes found inside the caldera of Newberry Volcano. The caldera was formed when the volcanic mountain collapsed, supposedly, several tens of thousands of years ago. Turns out that Newberry is one of the 160 volcanoes that the USGS monitors for volcano hazards. Although the current status of Newberry is normal, meaning that all is quiet and the volcano seems inactive, we wanted to know how much magma is currently beneath the Newberry Volcano and where it is located. In this study, we used seismic waves to, quote-unquote, see what is under the ground in Newberry. Seismic waves travel deep through the earth, much as waves or ripples travel on the surface of a pond. When there are obstructions, the waves are slowed down or broken up. In this study, we used the distortion of seismic waves to figure out where the magma chamber is beneath the Newberry Volcano and what its size is. Newberry Caldera is a large shield volcano located 40 miles east of the Cascade Mountains. Because it is a shield volcano, it has gently sloping sides and covers a large area. It is 20 miles across with a volume of about 80 cubic miles. That's a good size, guys. At the center, there is a large oval-shaped caldera that is 4 by 5 miles in diameter. The caldera formed when a large explosive eruption emptied the magma chamber, which then collapsed. Inside Newberry's caldera are Paulina Lake and East Lake, and also many volcanic cones and lava flows. The visitor center is close to where Paulina Creek cuts through the walls of the caldera and drains through a narrow gorge to the west. Several features suggest that there is still magma beneath Newberry Volcano. Listen to this, guys. This is very interesting. First, there are hot springs around both Paulina Lake and East Lake. At times, these hot springs are too hot to bathe in and must be mixed with the cold lake water to be comfortable. Secondly, drilling at the center of the caldera found temperatures of 540 degrees Fahrenheit. Wow. At about 3,000 feet below the caldera floor. The highest, check this out, the highest temperature ever recorded at a Cascade volcano. Wow, that's very interesting. Finally, Newberry Volcano had an eruptive episode about 1,400 years ago, so about 480 AD, supposedly. This big obsidian eruptive episode occurred over a period of about 200 years. It started with an eruption plume that spread volcanic ash to the east of the volcano. The final phase of the eruption produced the big obsidian flow, which covers about 1 square mile in the southern part of the caldera. The high temperatures, hot water, and recent eruptions all suggest that there may still be magma beneath the volcano. And there is, guys, just like we saw in the publication I talked about in the most recent video. Prior to this study, it was thought that a magma chamber was about as wide as the caldera, and it might be found about 2.5 miles beneath the caldera. This was based on work done by scientists at the USGS in the early 1980s, but they did not know how much molten rock is stored by this magma body. Now, this is a ripple tank. It makes plane waves. For these plane waves, the wavefront... See, this paragraph doesn't really make any sense because it has to do with an example they showed visually in the video. Remember, this is the text from the video. So we can get some good information from this, yes, but some of the paragraphs don't make sense because it have to be in the video. I don't know why the video is not up anymore. I'm going to actually email University of Oregon and see if they can either send it to me or re-upload the video or if somebody else has it. Now, magma beneath volcanoes is hard to see because the magma chambers are often small. Typically, scientists search for magma chambers by looking for seismic waves that are slowed down, which is what happens when they pass through molten rock instead of through solid rock. We could do a much better job when we also look at how the magma chamber disrupts the seismic waves. The team, together with a large group of volunteers, dug holes, installed seismometers, and hooked up the electronics. The instruments were spaced unusually close together to detect the magma chamber. To do this work, the team used an explosion to make a sound wave that traveled to the depths. Remember, sound is not just sound. It's not just audio. It's also vibrations, too, guys. Where they thought the magma chamber was located. The sound wave, or also vibration wave, moves through the rocks of the earth in the same way as ripples travel away when a pebble is dropped in a pond. Here you see a simulation, sadly, we can't see it, of the seismic wave field traveling away from the explosion and through the ground under Newberry Volcano. Where the main magma body is located, the wavefront becomes disrupted. Because of the presence of molten rock, the seismic waves slow down. This causes an indentation in the wavefront. Once the wave leaves the magma body, this indentation actually slowly recovers or heals. By the time the first wave arrives at the sensors on the surface, not much of the indentation is left. This is called wavefront healing, and is the reason why finding small magma bodies beneath volcanoes is so difficult. In addition to this first wave, some of the energy is focused within the magma body and then directed right back up to the surface at a different angle. This generates a second wave that is diagnostic of the existence of a magma body beneath Newberry. Based on the timing and the instruments on which the second wave is seen, scientists can determine the location and depth of Newberry's magma body. Emily's team found that the magma chamber stretches beneath most of the caldera. The magma chamber is down just over 2 miles below the surface, and it contains between 0.2 and 1.2 cubic miles of magma. That's a big difference, guys. 0.2 versus 1.2. So really, they don't know the exact amount down there, guys. But about 2 miles below the surface makes sense, according to the temperatures. But 540 degrees at 3,000 feet below the surface of Newberry Caldera, which is the hottest temperature ever recorded at the Cascade Volcano, that's pretty hot, guys. That's a little bit hotter than what most ovens can do. Actually, some ovens can go past 500 degrees, but some don't. Emily's team collected the raw data from the sensors and loaded it into applications that interpret the very basic numbers the sensors were recording. The team plotted the seismic data and studied the vertical motions that the sensors measured. In a software program used to invert the arrival times of the first waves, the team painted a basic picture of the magma chamber beneath Newberry Caldera. Then, using the second wave, the team discovered a small, shallow magma chamber under Newberry and wrote a paper about these findings that appeared in a scientific journal, which I believe is the publication that I showed you guys in the most recent video. Now, Emily wanted a better visualization of her computations, so she contacted two students studying digital arts at the University of Oregon and asked the two students to help. The students loaded the data from the computations into their 3D animation software and began to build a better-looking model of the magma chamber. Now we can more accurately visualize the size and shape of the magma body beneath the surface of Newberry Caldera. And here's a rendering of what the magma chamber under Newberry likely is composed of. There's the magma chamber made of mush. Apparently there's a bunch of mush in this area that could easily turn into actual molten magma. But yeah, there's the magma chamber, there's the system, and there's Newberry Caldera. And in this work, Emily's team used a new method to better detect small magma bodies. They looked not just at how fast the waves traveled, but also at the disruptions that generate new waves. There is not very much magma, but it is relatively shallow. And I have to say, 0.2 to 1.2 cubic miles of magma, that's not too much, but still, it could, if it erupted at full potential today, it'd put off a very impressive eruption. Actually, I'd be very intrigued to see one. I'd love to see a lava flow at Newberry, an active lava flow. As long as it doesn't hurt anybody or destroy anything, we're good. Our findings can be useful for scientists and decision makers who need to forecast the likelihood of an eruption and the potential volume. For example, if earthquakes start happening beneath Newberry Caldera, knowing where the magma chamber is and how large it is will help decide what the earthquakes mean for the potential of an eruption and how large that eruption might be. Okay, so that information was very interesting. Keep this in mind. Listen to what I have to say. So they drilled and discovered it is approximately 540 degrees Fahrenheit at about 3,000 feet down, which is the hottest temperature ever recorded at a Cascade volcano. Either that means the magma is shallower than they think, or there's a little bit more magma within the chamber than they think. But, you know, that's just my take on it. I could be extremely wrong. It could be the composition of magma down there, and maybe it's just hotter than normal. I don't know, but we're going to look at a few things. So remember to keep that in mind. 540 degrees Fahrenheit at 3,000 feet. And also keep in mind there is a wide range of magma composition ranging from basalt to rhyolite, or is it basalt? I think it's basalt, right? Sorry. So really, any type of magma really could be down there. So, and I don't think they know the exact composition of the magma. So let's take a look at some information about the different types of magma that are out there. And again, you see basalt to rhyolite is the composition. Most recent eruption is 1,300 years ago. Threat potential, very high, guys. Very high. That's the highest threat potential. That doesn't mean it's going to erupt today. That just means that's the threat potential if it ever did erupt. So right here, we're going to talk about the main composition of a magma chamber, the different types of magma, so on and so forth. So magma is the molten or semi-molten natural material from which all igneous rocks are formed. Magma is found beneath the surface of the Earth, and evidence of magmatism has also been discovered on other terrestrial planets and some natural satellites. Besides molten rock, magma may also contain suspended crystals and gas bubbles. Magma is produced by the melting of the mantle and or crust at various tectonic settings, including subduction zones, continental rift zones, mid-ocean ridges, and hot spots. Mantle and crustal melts migrate upwards through the crust where they are thought to be stored in magma chambers or transcrustal crystal-rich mush zones. During their storage in the crust, magma compositions may be modified by fractional crystallization, contamination with crustal melt, magma mixing, and degassing. Following their ascent through the crust, magmas may feed a volcano or solidify underground to form an intrusion. While the study of magma has historically relied on observing magma in the form of lava flows, magma has been encountered in situ, which means on site, locally, or on the premises, in place. It's Latin. Basically, it means if you drill down and you hit magma, which rarely doesn't happen. I mean, it rarely ever happens. That would be in situ. It has been encountered in situ 3 times during geothermal drilling projects, twice in Iceland, see magma uses for energy production, and once in Hawaii. Yeah, the Puna geothermal venture, guys. Yeah, I don't have to tell you guys about what... Yeah, okay, you know what I'm talking about. Physical and chemical properties of magma. Most magmatic liquids are rich in silica. Silicate? I think that's silicate, right? Silicate melts are composed mainly of silicon, oxygen, aluminum, iron, magnesium, calcium, sodium, and potassium. The physical behaviors of melts depend upon their atomic structures as well as upon temperature and pressure and composition. Viscosity is a key melt property in understanding the behavior of magmas. More silica-rich melts are typically more polymerized, with more linkage of silica tetrahedra, and so are more viscous. Dissolution of water drastically reduces melt viscosity. Higher temperature melts are less viscous. Remember, guys, viscous means thick. Something that is less viscous is more runny, right? It's more like water. High viscosity means it's thick, and it's like tar, you know? So, Newberry ranges from basalt to rhyolite, right? So we got these three right here we're going to focus on. Mafic, basaltic. Let's see, the temperature is up to 1,300 degrees Celsius, which is approximately 2,372 degrees Fahrenheit. Woo, that's really hot, guys. Wow, let's go back. Okay, so andesitic, which is intermediate magma, is around 1,000 degrees Celsius, which is approximately 1,832 degrees Fahrenheit. Now let's go back. Now felsic, which is rhyolitic magma, is less than 900 degrees Celsius. So, very interesting. So, this has a lower temperature, actually. Still extremely hot, guys. Still extremely hot, over like 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit. But still, you see, basaltic magma seems to be the hottest, actually, next to ultramafic. But basaltic magma, the eruptive behavior is gentle and occurs near divergent plate boundaries, hotspots, convergent plate boundaries. Intermediate and acidic magma, the viscosity is intermediate, obviously, and the eruptive behavior is explosive or effusive and can occur at convergent plate boundaries or island arcs. And then we see rhyolitic, which is the kind that I believe the magma at Yellowstone contains, is explosive or effusive. Common in hotspots in continental crust, Yellowstone National Park, and in continental rifts. Temperatures of most magmas are in the range of 700 degrees Celsius to 1300 degrees Celsius, 1300 degrees Fahrenheit to 2400 degrees Fahrenheit, but very rare carbonatite magmas may be as cool as 490 degrees Celsius, and comatite, actually I've never seen that word before, comatite, that's interesting, and comatite magmas may have been as hot as 1600 degrees Celsius. At any given pressure and for any given composition of rock, a rise in temperature past the solidus will cause melting. Within the solid earth, the temperature of a rock is controlled by the geothermal gradient and the radioactive decay within that rock. The geothermal gradient averages at about 25 degrees Celsius per kilometer with a wide range from a low 5 to 10 degrees Celsius per kilometer within oceanic trenches and subduction zones to 30 to 80 degrees Celsius per kilometer under mid-ocean ridges and volcanic arc environments. Okay. Basaltic magma density, 2,650 to 2,800. I don't want to look at the density. I'm mainly focusing on the temperatures right now because we're trying to figure out, okay, what's the composition of the magma chamber? If the magma chamber of Newberry is about, 2 to 3 miles below the crust, right? 3 to 6 kilometers. Then we might get a good idea of what the composition of the main composition of the magma chamber is and what type of eruption it could feed in the future. Now, it is usually very difficult to change the bulk composition of a large mass of rock. So composition is the basic control on whether a rock will melt at any given temperature and pressure. The composition of a rock may also be considered to include volatile phases, such as water and carbon dioxide. Excuse me. The presence of volatile phases in a rock under pressure can stabilize and melt fraction. The presence of even 0.8% water may reduce the temperature of melting by as much as 100 degrees Celsius. Conversely, the loss of water and volatiles from a magma may cause it to essentially freeze or solidify. Also, a major portion of almost all magma is silica, which is a compound of silicon and oxygen. Magma also contains gases, as we know, which expands as the magma rises. Magma that is high in silica resists flowing, so expanding gases are trapped in it. Pressure builds up until the gases blast out in a violent, dangerous explosion. Magma that is relatively poor in silica flows easily, so gas bubbles move up through it and escape fairly gently. Very interesting. Origins of magma by partial melting. Okay, this is very interesting, guys. So you know how some people say, you know, a volcano usually doesn't erupt until it reaches 50% melt or higher. That could be possible, but I don't think that's true, guys. I think it's much lower than 50%. Here, check this out. Okay, melting of solid rocks to form magma is controlled by three physical parameters: temperature, pressure, and composition. The most common mechanisms of magma generation in the mantle are decompression melting, heating by interaction with a hot mantle plume, and lowering of the solidus by compositional changes such as the addition of water. Mechanisms are discussed further in the entry for igneous rock. When rocks melt, they do so slowly and gradually because most rocks are made of several minerals, which all have different melting points. Moreover, the physical and chemical relationships controlling the melting are complex. As a rock melts, for example, its volume changes. When enough rock is melted, the small globules of melt, generally occurring between mineral grains, link up and they soften the rock. Under pressure within the earth, as little as a fraction. Listen to this. Under pressure within the earth, as little of a fraction of partial melting may be sufficient enough to cause melt to be squeezed from its source. Huh. Okay, that's interesting. Check this out. This is even more interesting. Melts can stay in place long enough to melt 20% or even 35%, which would be 20% melt, 35% melt, but rocks are rarely melted in excess of 50%. So does that mean that usually volcanoes do not see 50% melt? That's very interesting. So if this is true, Eruptions typically occur around 20% to 35% melt. Of course, it can last even longer than that, probably go up to 40, maybe even go up to 50, yes. But it says it rarely, if ever, exceeds 50%. Because eventually, the melted rock mass becomes a crystal and melt mush that can then ascend in mass as diaper. Not a diaper, guys. Don't worry, it's not a dirty, poopy diaper, which I have to change every day, by the way. Which may then cause further decompression melting. Okay, so that's interesting. So the melt, magma melt, the percentage of it is, seems to be a far less than what we're told. At least that's what it seems. Now, again, melts can stay in place long enough to melt 20% or even 35%, but rocks are rarely melted in excess of 50%, because eventually the melted rock mass becomes a crystal melt mush that can ascend in mass as a diaper, which then may cause further decompression melting and cause an eruption. And then there's more, many more references. And then down here, if you do go to this page, I'll leave a link to it in the description box below. They have some really good resources down here about the types of volcanic eruptions, especially limnic. Go to limnic eruptions. A limnic eruption, also termed a lake overturn, is a rare, and I'm talking very rare, guys, type of natural disaster in which dissolved carbon dioxide suddenly erupts from deep lake waters, forming a gas cloud capable of suffocating wildlife, livestock, and humans. Yeah, I didn't even know what a limnic eruption was. Sometimes it's connected to volcanic activity, sometimes it's not. But I thought that was very intriguing, guys. They got some really good examples of different volcanic eruptions and processes down here as well. Okay, so remember, the temperatures of most magmas are in the range of 700 degrees Celsius to 1300 degrees Celsius, or 1300 degrees Fahrenheit to 2400 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay, so since Newberry ranges from basalt to rhyolite, let's say the magma chamber is mainly made up of rhyolite. Since the temperature was recorded to be 540 degrees Fahrenheit at 3,000 feet below the surface, and the fact that rhyolite is mainly around 900 degrees Celsius, which is 1,652 degrees Fahrenheit, that means there could be rhyolitic magma only 2 to 3 miles beneath the crust. Kind of like what they said in the publication. Now let's say the magma chamber is mainly basaltic magma. This type of magma is usually much hotter than rhyolitic magma, so these temperatures can be achieved even if the magma chamber is much deeper than 2 to 3 miles. So this is somewhat consistent with what they found. 540 degrees Fahrenheit, which is approximately 260 degrees Celsius, is pretty hot for only 3,000 feet down, guys. So I'm thinking the magma chamber of Newberry contains more rhyolitic magma than basaltic magma. I'm thinking the next eruption at Newberry could be explosive and effusive. Because that could happen, guys. There could be large explosive eruptions, huge ash plumes, and then also lava flows issuing out of the crater. That can happen. Both can happen. There are many different volcanic eruptions, actually. Volcanic eruptions can range in style from these ones down here. Hawaiian, Strombolian, Volcanian, Plinian, Sertian, submarine, subglacial, and these magmatic eruptions right here, Hawaiian, Strombolian, on and on and on, these can change. One volcano can actually produce multiple different types of magmatic eruptions, which I thought that was very intriguing, guys. So let me know what you think of this below. Okay, so we know that Newberry is not dead, and it is still very active. Even the hot springs are sometimes far too hot to bathe in, even though I personally would never bathe in a real natural hot spring, since I know where all of that heat comes from. As of right now, no more low-frequency events have been reported for Newberry. That will likely change, however, since they seem to be occurring more and more the past few years. I'm going to add the recent low-frequency events to my Cascade low-frequency events page. I have not done that, I have not done that yet, but, I'm going to do it probably tonight if I get my monthly volcano update up in time. I'm not going to upload it tonight, but I am about to record it right now. Again, go to my website, go to the Seismic Events 2 drop-down menu, and click the Cascades page. I hope you enjoyed this video, and remember to always let me know if there are ever any mistakes or inconsistencies. Once the mistake or inconsistency has been confirmed, I will change it and retract the statement. God bless, and my next video is highly likely to be the monthly update unless something absolutely concerning happens tomorrow. God bless, and have a great day, guys!